Hey friends, welcome to the YouTube channel All About Electronics. So in this video, we will learn about the phase lock loop. Starting from computing to the communication, the phase lock loops are widely used in many electronics applications. So in the communication, they are used in the synchronization and the demodulation circuits. For example, in the FM demodulation and in the frequency shift keying, they are commonly used. Apart from that, when one wants to recover the clock from the incoming bit stream, then using the phase lock loop, it is quite possible. Moreover, in the communication system, for jitter and the noise reduction, the phase lock loop is commonly used. Then one of the most common application of the PLL is in the frequency synthesizers as well as in the tone generation. So using this phase lock loop, it is possible to generate the output frequency, which is multiple of the input frequency. And in the microprocessors, they are used in the generation of the stable system clock. So these are the some of the common applications of the phase lock loop. So now let us understand how this phase lock loop works. So as its name suggests, it is a control system or the control loop which maintains the same phase between the input and the output signal. So first of all, let us understand what do we mean by the phase difference. So as you can see over here, the two signals are of the same frequency, but there is a constant phase difference between the two signals. While in this second figure, the two waveforms starts at the same time, but they are of the different frequency. So in this case, the phase between the two signal is continuously changing with the time. So the phase lock loop system synchronizes the output signal with the input signal in the phase as well as in the frequency. So when the output frequency is equal to the input frequency and there is a no phase difference or the constant phase difference between the two signals, then we can say that the loop is in the lock condition. So the phase lock loop consists of three basic blocks: the phase detector, the loop filter or the low pass filter, and the voltage control oscillator. Now we have already discussed about the low pass filter and the voltage control oscillator in the earlier videos. So as we have discussed, in the voltage control oscillator, as the control voltage changes, then the frequency of the oscillation also changes. So whenever the loop is just turned on, then the VCO runs at the center frequency. And this frequency is also known as the free running frequency. Now the phase detector compares the input or the reference signal with the oscillator frequency. And based on that, it generates the error signal. Now this error signal is passed through the low pass filter, and the low pass filter generates the error voltage based on the error signal. And based on this error voltage, the VCO either increase or reduce the oscillator frequency until the oscillator frequency locks to the input frequency. And under the lock condition, there may be a no phase difference or the constant phase difference between the two signals. Now under the no lock condition, the PLL can acquire the lock only if the input signal is within the capture range of the PLL. That means whenever the input signal is within the capture range, then the VCO can lock to the input signal. That means the capture range is the range of input frequencies around the VCO center frequency onto which the loop can lock whenever it starts from the unlock condition. Then another important specification of the PLL is the lock range. So the lock range defines the range of input frequencies over which the loop remains in the lock condition once it has captured the input signal. So let's say the VCO is already locked to the input frequency F. Now if the input frequency changes, then the VCO will follow that frequency provided the input frequency is within the lock range. But if the input frequency goes out of the lock range, then the VCO starts running at the free running frequency. And it won't be able to lock to the input frequency until the input frequency is within the capture range of the PLL. So these two are the important specifications of the phase lock loop. So as I said earlier, the phase lock loop contains the three blocks: the phase detector, the low pass filter and the VCO. And we have already talked about the working of the low pass filter and the VCO in the earlier videos. So in this video, let us see in general how this phase detector circuit works and how it identifies the phase difference between the two signals. So let's say at a given point of time, one signal has some phase alpha, while another signal has some phase beta. That means the phase difference between the two signals is equal to alpha minus beta. And if the phase difference is very small, then we can say that the sine alpha minus beta is approximately equal to alpha minus beta. And this sine alpha minus beta can be written by the following expression. Or from this, we can say that when we multiply the two signals, then we will get the two terms. So the first term is the difference between the two phases, while the second term is the summation of the two phases. So the second term is the high frequency signal, and it can be eliminated using the low pass filter. That means just by multiplying the two signals, it is possible to generate the phase difference between the two signals. Now in the frequency domain, if we see the same phenomenon, then when we multiply the two signals, then we get the two terms. One is the summation of two frequencies, and the second is the difference between the two frequencies. So this high frequency component can be eliminated using this low pass filter, while this difference between the two frequencies contains the phase difference. And when this signal is passed through the low pass filter, then it provides the required error voltage for the VCO. So using this error voltage, it is possible to lock the VCO to the input frequency. So at the radio frequencies, the balanced mixer is used as a phase detector. While for the digital signals, the phase frequency detector or even an XOR gate can be used for the phase detection. So let us understand how the XOR gate can be used as a phase detector. So this is the truth table of the XOR gate. So the output of the XOR gate will be high when the two inputs are different. That means whenever the two signals are identical or whenever there is no phase difference between the two signals, then ideally the output of the XOR gate should be equal to zero. But actually if you see, you will find some spikes at the transitions. So if we take the average of this phase difference signal, then it will be approximately equal to zero. Similarly, when the phase difference between the two signals is 90 degree, then at the output we will get this type of waveform. And if we take the average of this phase difference signal, then we will get the output voltage which is half of the peak value. And whenever the phase difference between the two signals is 180 degree, then the output will be maximum and ideally it should be high for the all time. But actually there will be some spikes at the transitions. So if we take the average of this output waveform, then it will be the maximum value. That means as the phase difference between the two signal increases, then the average value of the output waveform will increase. So this is the plot of the phase difference and the average output value of the low pass filter. So as you can see, as the phase difference between the two signal increases from 0 to 180 degree, then the average output voltage will also increase linearly. That means this phase detector is the linear phase detector. But the phase relationship is linear only for 0 to 180 degree. Now ideally, the phase detector should provide a linear phase relationship from 0 to 360 degree. But in the XOR phase detector, as the phase difference increases beyond the 180 degree, then the average output voltage will start reducing. Moreover, it is difficult to identify which signal is leading or lagging. For example, irrespective of V1 is leading or lagging the V2 by 90 degree, we get the same output waveform. Apart from that, for the XOR gate to work as a linear phase detector, both signals should have approximately 50% of duty cycle. And whenever the two waveforms are operating at the different frequencies, then it is quite possible that the loop can get locked to the harmonic frequency. So these are the some of the problems with the XOR phase detector. And these problems can be eliminated using the phase frequency detector. So as shown in the figure, the phase frequency detector is designed using the D flip-flop and the AND gate. And the output of the detector is usually given to the charge pump circuit. So here, the output of the detectors is given to the PMOS and the NMOS circuits. So let us quickly understand the working of this phase frequency detector. So as you can see over here, the inputs of these both D flip-flops are connected to the logic high. And the two signals between which we want to measure the phase difference are given as a clock signal to these D flip-flops. So here, the signals V1 and V2 are given as a clock signal to these D flip-flops. So at the rising edge of these input signals, the output of the D flip-flop will become high. And here, these two flip-flops are marked as up and down. So when the up and down outputs are high, then the output of the AND gate will also become high, and that will reset these D flip-flops. And once the D flip-flop receives the clear signal, then the up and the down outputs will become zero. So in this particular case, when both up and down outputs are zero, then the output will get isolated from the detector circuit. And in this case, the Vout is the output of this voltage divider circuit. So in this particular case, it will be equal to VDD by 2. Now whenever only this up output is high, then the upper transistor will become high. And because of that, it will act as a short circuit. And in that case, the Vout will become VDD. Similarly, when the down output is high, at that time, this lower transistor will become high. And that will pull down the output Vout to the 0 volt. So using this circuit, it is possible to identify which signal is leading or lagging. Moreover, if both signals are running at the different frequencies, then also it is possible to correct them. For example, let's say here V1 is the input signal to the PLL and the V2 is the output of the VCO. So as you can see, here the V1 is running at the higher frequency. Moreover, this V1 signal is also leading the V2. So at the rising edge of this V1 signal, the up signal will become high and it will remain high till the rising edge of this V2. Now once again, this up output will become high at the rising edge of this V1 and it will remain high until the rising edge of this V2. So in this case, as the V1 is leading the V2, so the up output will become high. But on the other end, if V2 is leading the V1 or V1 is lagging the V2, in that case, this down output will become high. So from the up and the down output, it is easy to identify which input is leading and lagging. So in this case, when the up output is high, then the overall output voltage will be pulled up from the VDD voltage to the VDD by 2. So if we take the average of this output voltage, then it will be more than the VDD by 2. That means the VCO frequency will increase until it matches the input frequency. Similarly, let us see the case when the input frequency is less than the oscillator frequency. So in this case, as V2 is leading the V1, so the down output will become high and it will remain high till the rising edge of this V1. And whenever this down output is high, at that time, the overall output will be pulled down to the 0 volt from the VDD by 2. So if we take the average of the overall output waveform, then in this case, it will be less than the VDD by 2. That means in this case, the control voltage of the VCO will reduce. And due to that, it will bring down the VCO frequency. So this is the basic working principle of this phase frequency detector. Now as I mentioned earlier, the phase lock loop is commonly used in the frequency synthesizer circuit. So in this basic PLL loop, when we introduce the divide by N counter in the feedback, then it is possible to multiply the output frequency by the factor of N. So let's say, the input frequency or the reference frequency to the PLL is equal to 1 MHz. And let's say the VCO frequency is also 1 MHz. Now when we introduce the divide by 10 counter in the feedback, then the output of that counter will be 100 kHz frequency. That means the one input to the phase detector is 1 MHz frequency, while the second input is 100 kHz. So now the phase lock loop controls the VCO in a such a way that the output of the counter provides the 1 MHz frequency. That means the output of the VCO has to be at the 10 MHz frequency. Or in other words, we can say that the output of the phase lock loop is 10 times the input frequency. So in this way, using this phase lock loop, it is possible to multiply the input frequency. Similarly, if we introduce this divide by N counter block before the phase detector, then it is possible to divide the output frequency by the factor of N. That means if Fi is the input frequency, then the output frequency will be equal to Fi divided by N. So in this way, the phase lock loop can be used in the frequency synthesizers to multiply or divide the input frequency by the factor of N. So I hope in this video you understood what is phase lock loop, what are the applications of the phase lock loop, and how this phase lock loop system works. So if you have any question or suggestion, do let me know here in the comment section below. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe to the channel for more such videos.